Thank you, everybody. My name is Francesco Sindico. I'm the director of the Strathclyde Centre for Environmental Law and Governance at the Law School here at Strathclyde University in Glasgow. And this is the last of three very exciting events we hosted here at the university today. And we have the pleasure of having a keynote speaker, Professor Gabriel Eckstein, which I will briefly introduce to you in just a second, and a panel of multidisciplinary experts for what is our SCELG guest lecture, our second SCELG guest lecture. The first one took place 2 years ago. Professor Chanbao Qin from Wuhan University talking about developing environmental law in China. And this is our second guest lecture, which we are delighted to host and organize. Let me just take advantage of a few words about the center itself. The center is now a consolidated hub here at the university. It comprises staff, PhD researchers, postdocs, students, student-led projects, external funded projects, and a number of knowledge exchange activities. And it really has grown exponentially, especially thanks to our PhD cohort in the last year. This is just one of the many activities that we organize, and we are delighted to do so. But let me introduce you our keynote. It is a real pleasure to have Gabriel Eckstein here at Strathclyde. I have known Gabriel for 5 years now. I've been lucky enough to co-author with him, so we worked together on a number of occasions. And Gabriel comes from Texas A&M University, the law school there. A lot of people will know him in the international water law field for his International Water Law Project, an incredible useful resource for policymakers, experts, researchers, students. He was former advisor to the UN International Law Commission in the work it done on transboundary aquifers. Gabriel has an incredible first-hand experience on the topic that he will be talking today. And he will, in his presentation, which you have the title up there, talk not just about the bigger picture, the general picture, but he will also zoom down, and I will not give too much away, to a specific case study, which is close to his heart, I would say, and not just where he lives. So after Gabriel, just to say how this guest lecture will span out, will work out, we will give Gabriel enough time to expand on his view of transboundary aquifers. And after that, I will invite three distinguished experts, only one of which is an international lawyer. And we deliberately did that, not because two are enough, but because we wanted to keep it more multidisciplinary. And I'll introduce them once Gabriel has finished his keynote. But that will allow three different fields to comment on Gabriel's presentation, on the topic that he's presenting, and allow the whole audience, and possibly also the people looking at this guest lecture online, and they can do it via Twitter, to comment and engage with the speakers. So without further ado, I give the floor to Gabriel Eckstein.
No, as Francesco said, we've known each other for about 5 years, and I've known him from the different universities he's been affiliated with, different projects he's been affiliated with, and it is so much fun. That's the best way to describe it. It's so much fun to work with somebody like this because he's so energetic and so excited about the subject matter that it's infectious. And it's really been a wonderful experience to know him and to work with him and collaborate with him. And again, I really appreciate the opportunity to come here and speak today on a topic which has been close to my heart in a lot of ways. A little bit more about my background. I have a geology degree. I started off as a geologist, maybe a bit reluctantly. My father is a professor of hydrogeology, and he was at university at Kent State. He was 37 years, and before that, he was working with on various consulting projects with other universities and so on. So I think he's got over 40 years, 45 years, longer, close to 50 years of hydrogeology experience, which has permeated into me to varying extent. And it's really been a real love to be able to sort of follow my father's footsteps, but in a slightly different capacity, a different direction. So what I'm going to be talking about today is about transboundary aquifers. And this is a real, in my opinion, I'm biased, I know, it's a fascinating area of law and science, but it's also a very strange one. And I say strange because it's a subject matter that we're not used to. We're not used to talking, to discussing groundwater resources, primarily because we can't see it. And because we can't see the thing we're talking about, we really have a difficult time addressing the subject matter, dealing with the subject matter, whether it is in terms of laws and regulations or policies or even the science. And I'll talk a little bit about the science. We have to create these conceptual models because we can't slice a hill or a mountain. You could, very expensive, to see what's on the inside. But even then, you can only see it in two dimensions. How do you put this thing, aquifer, into three dimensions? We have to do it computationally or through computer programs. And we create these models, and it's still not the thing. It's a caricature of the real thing called groundwater, called aquifer. And so it's a very awkward subject matter, which then makes it even more awkward to talk about law and policy and management. So I think it's an absolutely fascinating topic and subject area. And so let me give you an outline of what I plan to do in terms of my talk. Do a little bit of history of international law for transboundary aquifers. Very short. There's not much. It's a prequel. I'll talk a little bit about what appears to be a slow evolution. And a lot of people are complaining about the slow pace of the development of international law for transboundary aquifers. Then again, you'll see that we really haven't spent that much time on it as compared to other things like rivers and lakes. I'll talk about the bases, how we develop international law, and specifically for transboundary aquifers, groundwater in general, and what we really need, what's missing for developing that kind of law. And then I'll go into the case study, which Francesco suggested is both close to me physically, since I live and work in Texas, but also has been become an overwhelming project that I've become involved in, and is really been fascinating study, U.S.-Mexico border. So many of you have seen this map before, transboundary rivers, river basins around the world. We had earlier today a conversation about how many there may be, 263, or is it 273, or the World Bank says 300 plus, and they don't say what plus means. How do you define the tributaries and so on? Suffice to say, we've got a lot of agreements. We've got a lot of agreements over these 260, 70, 300 transboundary water courses, surface waters, rivers, lakes, and so on. In fact, and I put 263 just for the sake of argument to have a number, but we do have over 3,600 agreements for managing transboundary rivers and lakes and water courses in general. Now, granted, most of those are for navigation because we really didn't start talking about non-navigational uses until around the Industrial Revolution, about 100 some years ago. early 1900s when we really started seeing the development of treaties for non-navigational uses. But as you can see, that's still thousands of treaties that we have around the world for a few hundred watercourses. In contrast, I forgot to mention, we also have a couple of global conventions, right? You've heard about them, the Watercourses Convention, the UNECE has one too, and I put the second ring global because the UNECE Water Convention has opened its door for global, at least UN membership. You have to be a member of the UN to be, but these are global members, global treaties regarding watercourses. But in contrast, I don't know if you've seen this map. These are transboundary aquifers, transboundary groundwater bodies, and according to IGRAG, which is the International Groundwater Research Something Center, they're now a UN affiliated institute, over 600, and that's as of a few months ago. I've been checking their website. They have been, that number has been growing almost exponentially. And I remember about 10 years ago, we didn't, the number was zero that we knew of. Well, we knew there was the Genovese because they had a treaty. And 10 years ago, 15 years ago, we didn't know about the Guarani in South America. Well, Nubian sandstone, we knew. So we knew about a few of them, but nobody had ever compiled the number. And now we know there's at least double the number of surface water resources. So great. So we have 270, 80, 90, 300 surface water bodies and thousands of agreements. And now we have 600 transboundary aquifers and groundwater bodies. And how many agreements do we have? Well, there's the Genovese aquifer agreement. We have, oh yeah, Minute 242, which is really about the salinity of the Colorado River. And then they threw in a couple of provisions, number 5 and 6, about we won't pump from this aquifer over here. So it's not a management, it's not a planning, it's not a allocation, it's just a agreement not to extract from that aquifer. Pending the development of a border-wide agreement on the U.S.-Mexico border, I'll get to that a little bit later. Here we have data sharing, monitoring, cooperation agreements on the Nubian sandstone and northwestern Sahara aquifer. What else do we have? Oh, here is the Guarani agreement, still not ratified. It's been signed, so there's intention by all the countries, but it's not been implemented. What else do we have? Oh, a couple of MOUs. Abbotsford Sumas Aquifer, this is the Hueco Bolson Aquifer, Yula Maiden, and as of 2-3 weeks ago, the DC Aquifer. They're either what they call a Memorandum of Understanding or Memorandum of Agreement, MOU or MOA, not a treaty. It's a, in legal terms, it's good intentions. We aspire to abide by the terms of this document, this instrument we've entered into, but you know, we aspire to. It doesn't mean we shall. So there's a question about, you know, do they really form any kind of basis for international law? Remember, 3,600 for surface water. This is for groundwater. Okay, Europe's got...
Gabriel,
yes?
Can you tell us the distinction between transboundary aquifer and aquifer bodies?
It's a good question, and I don't have a good answer. IGRAG has started to define transboundary aquifers and aquifer bodies, and part of the problem... Part of the problem I'll talk about when I do the case study is how do you define the geographic contours of an aquifer? And as a preview, is it the saturated zone? Is it the geologic formation? Is it? There's a couple different ways you can go about it. And so on many of these, IGRAG, the bottom line is they don't know, is this one aquifer? Or is this two or three aquifers somehow integrated? There's just not enough data, so they call them aquifer bodies. That's the best explanation I can give you. It's not a great definition, but it's because we really don't know what to call these things. We know it's groundwater, but we don't know where the boundaries are. And so, okay, Europe has the framework directive and the daughter directive on groundwater that has some relevance to transboundary aquifers. And then this big one, that's the draft articles. Draft articles, not convention, not treaty, not protocol, not it's a series of norms that were drafted by the UN International Law Commission. You might argue they're progressively developed. They're not representing international law, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. That's it. I'm not going to click anymore. That's it. This is the basis that we have to work with for trying to identify international law for transboundary aquifers. It's a challenge. It's a real challenge because we don't have much to go on. And this is largely because our use of aquifers in general is a rather recent phenomenon. Now, yes, there have been wells for thousands of years, Middle East and other places around the world, but our real use, to the extent that we do today, where 50% of the world's population gets their fresh water for drinking and hygiene from groundwater, that's a recent phenomenon. World War II, we started to develop technology to be able to drill more than 100 feet, thousands of feet. It's only in the last 50, 60, maybe 75 years that we've been able to really focus on groundwater as a source of fresh water that we started saying, hey, this one crosses the border. Maybe we need to be thinking about it. And this is really reflected also in the legal history. So if you look at the treaties and the agreements that have been forged over the last umpteen years, groundwater doesn't appear until the 1800s. And in fact, it only appears as a secondary, or I might even say tertiary issue. The main focus was on the river, on the lake. Oh yeah, and there's some wells, or there's a spring or a well, or they weren't even, don't even use the word groundwater in those early treaties. There's just a couple of treaties I have listed here. 1888 agreement between the United Kingdom, who was then managing Somalia, and France, which was then managing Djibouti. And this agreement affords both parties common rights to use the Houdou well. So not groundwater, it's a well. Actually, Versailles Treaty that ended World War I and the delimitation of the common border between Germany and Belgium referred to the use of springs. 1923 exchange of notes between France on behalf of Syria and the UK on behalf of Palestine addressed the use of spring water. So you see this late 1800s, early 1900s, the focus is on springs and wells. They know there's water underneath the ground, but it's not really the focus. It's really on surface waters, delimiting borders, frontiers, and groundwater becomes really a secondary issue. As we get into the 1900s, well, as I said, 1940s, 50s, World War II is when we started really developing the technology, and that's when we see a little more interest in transboundary waters. Not until the early 1970s do we see a treaty actually refer to groundwater directly, and that was the Minute 242 I mentioned on the U.S.-Mexico border. The treaty, which is it's actually an amendment to the Rio Grande Colorado River Treaty, this amendment really focuses on the salinity in the Colorado River, and then it adds these two provisions on groundwater in the Sonora-Arizona border region. Again, for the purpose of not pumping. That was what they agreed to do. Convention on the Protection, Utilization, Recharge, and so on. Genevieve's Aquifer. That's the gold standard today. Well, that's the only standard today because that's the only true management agreement we have in the world that was done in 1978, reconceived in 2008. It had a 30-year sunset, so 30-year duration. 2008, they reevaluated, reassessed that agreement and renewed it. I've mentioned the two data sharing consultation monitoring agreements in Northern Africa, EU groundwater directive, and you can see I've listed these in terms of dates. Here's the draft articles. They started in 2002, working on those, and they submitted them to the UN General Assembly in 2008. EULA made an aquifer system. This is this MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, 2009. Guadani, 2010, not in force. And this DC aquifer MOA just this past month. That's all we have to work with in terms of trying to identify international law for transboundary aquifers. What law exists out there? There may be some others, a few others that I've missed, but this is the main. This is what we have to work for, not 3,600 agreements. Really a challenge to say this is what the trend is or the law is for managing transboundary aquifers. Well, I have to admit, I have tried to identify the trends. It's hard. And myself and a few others have suggested, well, looking at these treaties and looking how these states behave and their actions, we might be able to say that, hey, it looks like we have a majority of this really small sample talking about exchanging data and information. Prior notification, informing each other before they take on any kind of major project. And using that as an obligation, I must inform you before I undertake any project that may affect or may have a detrimental impact on this transboundary aquifer. Again, I'm just identifying trends. I can't say definitively this is international law. Substantive rules, and I broke these down into procedural rules and substantive rules. Substantive rules, cooperation. Again, the fact that they entered into an MOU or MOA or a treaty or any kind of agreement is indicative of cooperation. You can argue that it's a procedural rule, but also a substantive rule. I've chosen to put it here as a substantive obligation to cooperate. And then the two very familiar rules from international water law, equitable and reasonable utilization, and no significant harm. Now, I put all these on here because these MOAs and MOUs and the few treaties that we have, they either use these terms or they suggest these kinds of norms. And again, I'm just trying to identify trends on very little practice, on very little. When we talk about state practice, that's how state acts in terms of, you know, when they enter into an agreement or whether they don't have an agreement and just act in a certain way. That's what we mean by state practice. Handful of instruments, some of which are legally unenforceable. A memorandum of understanding, from a legal technicality, it's not enforceable. You can take it to court and the judge will throw it out. So is that really a good basis for international law? Well, some of us as academics are hopeful, and so we write about it, and we suggest it might be, but, you know, you can only take what we say so far, and you shouldn't take it very far. International law really needs to have a strong foundation. So the best we can do is talk about trends and development of trends, at least at this point, because we have very little experience with managing transboundary aquifers. So what do we need? What can we do to expedite the development of international law for transboundary aquifers? Well, state practice. Well, how do you get state practice? How do you get states to actually engage in the management of transboundary aquifers? Well, they've got to have a need. The state is not going to act on anything unless there's a direct need. You can also talk about interests. They have to have an interest. Maybe they don't have a need, but they have an interest. And I'll give you an example. I need the water. Okay, that's the direct need. I need to provide water for my population, for my agriculture, industry, and so on. That's the first example. The second example, I don't necessarily need the water, but I don't want you taking it because you claim you have a need. So I have an interest to protect what I think is, it's on my land, it's on my territory, my sovereignty. So I have an interest. Well, apparently most countries around the world have not expressed needs and or interests strongly enough to the extent that they enter into an agreement with their neighbors. So it's very hard to twist a country's arm and suggest you really should be interested in this, you really should have a need. It's a big challenge to do that. Why they haven't? You know, everybody reads the front page of all the USCA news and all the water news services, and occasionally you see it in some of the other mainstream news services. Water shortages, you've heard of what's going on in California, you know what's going on in the Middle East. Water stress, water scarcity. It's very frustrating for those of us in the water field that we know that there's this water challenge going on, but apparently the countries don't, or they choose to ignore it. And I'll talk about that in the context of the U.S.-Mexico border in a little bit. Cooperation, well, that's part of state practice. We want them cooperate. They either have to cooperate, well, to whatever they do, there's a transboundary aquifer. They have to do something in relation to that aquifer. Hopefully that's cooperation, which then builds trust. All these things you need as a basis for state practice, and we just don't have much. But there's one more huge, huge thing that you need, because you really can't act, well, I shouldn't say that. States can act on interests and needs without this last category, but it's really a problem if they do, and that's the knowledge. And this is one of the problems that we have right now globally. Brings back to the question about what's a transboundary aquifer versus a groundwater body? We don't know the contours. We don't even know where all these aquifers are located. We don't know how to characterize them. We don't know their quality, their water quality. We don't know their chemistry. We don't know their directional flow. We don't know where they're being recharged. We don't know where the natural discharge is taking place. We don't know how much we're extracting from all these aquifers around the world. Some of them we do. From many of them we have very good data. But on a global basis, it is one of the biggest deficits of knowledge that we have on such a critical health issue, agricultural issue, and energy issue, you name it. Water touches everything, you know this. And we have this huge gap in information on groundwater. That's how we know it. I mentioned earlier, we can't see it, so we have to draw these schematics. That's what we think is going on underneath the ground, this diagram. This is called a conceptual model. This is what we conceptualize the aquifer to look like, at least a cross-section of it. We can't know if this is definite, but based on studies and analyses and so on, this is the best we can do. And this is just an example. This is not the model for every aquifer around the world. This is just a generic model. And there's dozens of different types of aquifers in terms of the type of formation, the porosity, the permeability, the composition, the type of material that forms the aquifer, the recharge and discharge and climate and so on. It's a huge challenge to try to figure out what is really going on under the ground. And then we decide to put a border on top and decide that's mine and this is yours. Very artificial on something that is naturally complex. I mentioned earlier just trying to identify the contours. Three possibilities that I've been working with in terms of how you can define an aquifer geographically. True aquifer boundary, which refers to the saturated formation, the saturated part of the aquifer, and the degree of transmissivity and storage capacity. Okay, that's one way to come up with the lines, the geographic lines. Well, how about the basin aquifer boundary, which refers to the entire hydrologic basin? That could be much larger than the true aquifer boundary. Or the geologic formation itself, which may correlate to the basin aquifer boundary or may not, but certainly will not always correlate to the saturated part. So trying to decide, and there's no standardization. There's no methodology that's been standardized between countries or internationally. And I'll show you in a minute, U.S.-Mexico border, we don't even talk about these things, let alone come up with one or two or three different methodologies. So let me talk about this Mexico study, because this has given me the opportunity to try to implement on real live aquifers. It's like my clients. I'm a lawyer, and this is my client. I'm trying to, I get to work with real live aquifers here, and try to figure out everything I've just described in terms of how you characterize and delineate and identify and so on the U.S.-Mexico border. And this is a place where we have a high level of trust and cooperation, historically, fairly good relations with the Mexicans. We have some agreements on surface water, but none on groundwater, except that, remember that MENA 242, the negative agreements? We won't use the water in this area of Sonora and Arizona until we develop a comprehensive agreement. They haven't yet. Dearth of experience. There's no experience. Lack of focus from federal governments. In my opinion, the interests that a capital federal government may have in what happens on the border is in direct proportion to the distance geographically that capital lies from the border. So Washington, D.C., Mexico City, I mean, hundreds and hundreds of miles away, they have so many other interests. This is not a big deal to them right now, despite we don't know anything. I mean, I shouldn't say anything. We know some things, but I can't even tell you the number and location of all the aquifers on the border. Well, I can't today because of the study, but before the study, it wasn't available. And this is the United States, one of the most technologically advanced and developed countries in the world. I remember speaking with researchers on the in Mexico and research on the U.S., and they were reluctant to cooperate publicly. Privately, they're okay. And this is before 2008, before the 2005 TAP agreement, the U.S. Government put a few million dollars into researching the border aquifers. They were reluctant because their governments were reluctant for them to participate. It's better not to know than to figure it out and realize that's our water, that's their water, how much water is being used. Let's just go ahead and pump it out. That's what they said to me, because that's what they were getting from their respective governments. And in the U.S. certainly you have independent researchers, but they were not getting funding. They just could not get funding for this kind of research. So very little coordination. Almost a 2,000-mile border. This is the area we're talking about, all the way from the Gulf of Mexico here, all the way to the Pacific Ocean. You've got four U.S. states on the north sides, eight on Mexican states. On the U.S. side, administration is very local. Water quantity is a state issue. It's not a federal issue. On the Mexican side, it's all federalized. There's some local implementation, state implementation, but it's all federal approach. MENA 242, I mentioned, this is the only agreement that we have on transboundary aquifers on the border that's official. And I highlight official because, if you remember the second map I had on transboundary aquifers, there was a little red dot over the Hueco Bolson, because we have an MOU between the water utilities of El Paso and the water utilities of Ciudad Juarez. They have a memorandum of understanding to share information. It's not enforceable, and it's between the water utilities, not even the municipalities. So we have these unofficial arrangements on the border. But officially, this is it, and it says we're not going to do anything. We agree to limit withdrawals in this area of Arizona and Sonora. They had to stop pumping. Well, no, I should say, they limited the withdrawals to the extent that they wouldn't reverse the flow, which is what the problem was. The Mexicans were pumping so much on the border that they reversed the flow, because the flow used to go from Mexico to the U.S., and they reversed the flow. And so the Americans were getting upset, and so what the Americans did was they entered in this agreement to limit the flow to the level that the flow would not be reversed, and then they put in wells on the U.S. side to ensure that the flow doesn't reverse. And they don't use that water for irrigation or agriculture. They actually put it in the Colorado River, and they use that to pay Mexico for the amount of water they owe in through the Colorado River. What's that? Yes, so I mean, it was flowing already to Mexico, but we couldn't have it do it underneath the border, reverse the flow. We have to pump it out ourselves because it's our water, and then we'll put it in the river to let it flow into Mexico. Yes. Groundwater is important on this border. We've got 15 million people on the border within about a 50 or 100 mile radius of both sides. That number is going to go to 20 million within 5 years. The population growth is faster in this border region than it is in the U.S. And I'm not sure of Mexican population growth rate, but in the next 5 years, going from 15 to 20 million on both sides together, that's a pretty significant rise. These sister communities, and there's I think a total of 12 or 14 sister communities that rely exclusively on groundwater because they don't have surface water in their areas. And I put Ciudad Juarez in here. The sister city is actually El Paso, except that Ciudad Juarez relies 100% on groundwater, while El Paso has reduced their groundwater requirements to about 40, I think it's 40%, and they've been relying more on the river, and they've been buying some other water rights on the U.S. side. So there's a sister city here, but it's only Ciudad Juarez that is 100% reliant. The point is, once the aquifers go, there's nothing else. And I can't tell you if any of these aquifers are fossil aquifers or what the rate of recharge, except for a couple of the aquifers, the Hueco Bolson, the San Pedro area in Arizona. There's a few that have been developed, but very few, very few. Remember seventh grade geography? When you had these beautiful maps of your country. And I'm sure this is in every country. Because look, they do the same thing in Mexico. Do you see what they're doing? Beautiful colors here in Mexico and beautiful colors here in the U.S. There's this gray country over here and above and below. Oh, this gray country above us. And it's these sharp lines at the border. And so when you look at these water boundaries, they naturally stop at the border, don't they? Well, that's the method of science, groundwater, that we're still doing today in many universities and many geological surveys. We are experimenting and characterizing and doing all sorts of great work up to the border and not beyond, and we don't share. And that's why we don't even know where the transboundary aquifers are located, because we're not even sharing the information. I would call these official, unofficial studies. UNESCO from 2005 said that there are 8. IGRAG in 2009 says 10. I believe the latest map shows 11. I think they found one more. Professor Mummy, who's one of the leaders in this field on the U.S.-Mexico border, he found 18 based on his research. And this Good Neighbors Environmental Board report said 20. Now they didn't cite. I couldn't figure out where they got their number from 20. And this is the IGRAG map from 2009, trying to identify. And you can see even this one stops at the border. They weren't sure about that. So what do you do? Well, before I get to what do you do, the consequences. I won't bore you to this. I mean, pollution, depletion. This is the Hueco Bolson up until about the 2000. After about 2000, especially on the El Paso side, they really buckled down and reduced their extraction. And so this depletion really started to level off. So they've done a better job there. But I can't tell you about the other aquifers because we don't monitor them very well. It's a serious problem, pollution, depletion all across the border. So here comes our study. We've been trying to collect all this information, whatever information we can find, on both sides. We've gone to Conagua in Mexico, which is the water administration body at the federal level. We've gone to universities in Mexico to see what research they've done. We then went to the U.S. side. Oh, it's not federal. We've gone to every state, geological survey. We've gone to universities. We've gone to researchers who are affiliated with institutes that are not academic. This has been a serious task, and I have to give kudos to Rosario Sanchez, Dr. Sanchez from Texas A&M, because she's the one who's been doing the groundwork. I've been the director, telling her, here's what we should do, and she's the one who's been doing all this work. Really tremendous work, and she has a grad assistant working with her on this. And this is at least my goal and her goal in trying to do this. We want to get to a state where we can actually provide recommendations or suggestions of which aquifers, because we know where they are now, or we think we are, can be managed as a unit in terms of good governance. And then what good governance means for that particular aquifer versus the one next to it, because it may have different characteristics, unique characteristics. One might be a karst aquifer, the other one might be a sandstone aquifer, which have different flow regimes and recharge and discharge and so on. So that's our goal for the entire border. Collect data. That's what we've been doing for the last, I'd say, 18 months. We're very far from this purpose, this objective that we're trying to get to. Types of information, and I should have mentioned this earlier. What does this list look like? Anybody recognize this list? Remember, actually, we talked in the other session about equitable and reasonable utilization, the factors. One of the, I think, mistakes that us lawyers have made is we focused on this information in the context of water rights, because equitable and reasonable utilization is a method for determining water rights. How much do you get? How much do I get? What benefits do you get? What benefits do I get? Well, how do we determine? Well, if we look through all these factors, we should be able to figure this out. I think we've missed a big issue here, and that is, before we can even talk about rights, we just need the basic information to just figure out where the aquifer is. I mean, it's that simple. Where is the aquifer? What does it look like? How does it flow? What's the chemical composition? Who's using it? How much are they using? Nobody meters their wells in these areas. So I don't want to talk about water rights. I don't want to talk anything about equitable, reasonable, no harm, because I don't think it's any use. What we need is a focus on data generation and monitoring. That's where I think the real value of developing agreements today, that's where I think they should come in. And that's what we're trying to do for the U.S.-Mexico border. Challenges. Mexico side has actually been relatively easy compared to the U.S. side. Mexico, because it's all federalized, and they seem to have an organized chaos, but it's organized to some extent. They sort of know where things are. On the U.S. side, researchers don't know what they're doing, what the other researcher is doing. They can't even tell, you know, oh, we're working on the same aquifer, because for whatever reason, there's a communication gap. We found so many researchers who are working on the same aquifer, and they didn't know it. Maybe if they work through USGS or they're funded through some kind of a USGS grant or EPA grant or some other funding mechanism, they find out. But then it's published, and for whatever reason, it disappears. It's published, it's out there, but it's not, I don't understand it. It just disappears from the collective. And so we're having a really hard time on the US side collecting all this information. We keep running into people who may have information. We're like, well, I need to get your phone number. Because that's how we've been working on the U.S. side. Having said that, all these researchers on both sides, They're using all sorts of methodologies. There's nothing is harmonized. There's no standardization. And so it's really hard to correlate the information from both sides of the border. It's hard to correlate the information from the same side of the border when two researchers working on the same aquifer are using different methodologies. Makes it very challenging. Give you an example. I talked about the true aquifer versus hydrologic basin. Here's the Hueco Bolson on the Mexico side. On Mexico, they're a lot more uniform. They tend to use the hydrologic basin boundary. On the U.S., there is no uniformity. On this particular one, they use the true aquifer. So I don't know if this is the right contours for this entire aquifer. That's the information we have. Arizona. If you look here, things don't quite match up. This is the information we have from the Mexican side. This is the information we've gathered from the U.S. side. And I can't tell you why it doesn't match up. There's no river boundary here. I don't believe that there's some kind of rift, tectonic activity that's kind of sheared the aqua. I don't know. But this is the information we have. And we've been able to generate this for the entire border. Now, it's a challenge because it's not conclusive because we just don't know about whether the aquifer information we have on the north side of the border equates with the south. Now, where we do have some kind of certainty, we've decided to come up with this categorization system in terms of certainty. Reasonable certainty, well, that's where we have the information from both sides where either it's harmonized or we can harmonize it or it makes sense. Some certainty and limited certainty. And we're still playing around with these definitions because not all of our aquifers kind of fit these definitions in terms of our level of certainty. But these are the categories we've gone with. And the result is 16 aquifers of which we're certain are transboundary, 8 with some certainty, and 12 with very limited certainty. Was it 36? Put 36 potential aquifers on the U.S.-Mexico border. If you remember the other slide, 8, 10, 12, or 8, 10, 18, and 20 were the numbers. There may be as many as 36. Maybe. I don't know. That's what the map looks like. Now, you guys get the first dibs. This is the first ever screening of this map. The full report is being presented by Rosario, Dr. Sanchez, at the World Water Congress next week. This is our first attempt. So this is our first results based on levels of certainty. We're still developing this. We're still working with this. We're still trying to get more information. A lot of question areas that we just don't know. We think there's an aquifer that's transboundary there, but we just don't have enough information. Next steps, we're going to continue gathering information. This is going to be a multi-year project. What I really want to do is this last part, and this I think is going to be multi-year. I want to create levels of mapping, not just the geographic contours, but also extraction use, recharge information, discharge information, social issues, exploitation in a variety of levels. So you can put these maps over one another so that we can get to the point of characterizing for the purpose of hopefully get to good governance, because we want to identify the challenges and the concerns for each of these specific transboundary aquifers and then be able to develop governmental management units and say, this aquifer or these two aquifer bodies together can be managed together, or they can't be managed. We want to be able to say that or make recommendations and then provide some additional commentaries on what unique challenges that aquifer has versus a different one in terms of its management schemes. So that's our goal. A couple of papers that I've written. The first one up here is the one that's more directly related to this project. And we will have a paper coming out of Dr. Sanchez's report at the Congress next week on this first findings. But we're hoping this is going to be a multi-year activity. So thank you all. I appreciate the opportunity, and Francesco.
Thank you very much, Gabriel. That was amazing. Actually, can I ask the three panelists, the three experts, to come to the table, to the floor, so that we can, once we're ready, begin the actual panel discussion. But while you come, and before I present you, chair's privilege, you touched a lot of elements that I've, to some extent, come to see myself. So practically, what you're doing is you're asking for information, you're trying to find information, and you don't find it. And you know it's there. You know it was there, it got lost. I had exactly the same answers in the Guarani. After the Guarani project finished in 2009, you go to the places where this information apparently was, and it's either not there anymore, or it's just very difficult to get your hands on. So it's another trend, if you want, global. Another point that I thought was really, really interesting, and I'm really, I almost see a global project, which is about this groundwater in the context of a transboundary aquifer in a sister community. You have them on your border, you have them between Italy and Slovenia, Gorica and Nova Gorica. I'm sure there are many other examples which could be really interesting to look at. And the last bigger question before I introduce our panel of experts, I think the really big question that I see coming out is, can you have an international legal instrument without knowledge, or can some sort of an international legal instrument in the context of transboundary aquifer promote further knowledge? And I think that's an interesting question which I have seen now very much debated, for example, in the SADC region, where there is not a lot of information, but there are attempts. Cooperation seems to be more or less, if not ripe, they're debating it. But there's, as you said, in some cases, we don't even know whether it's a transboundary. So these are some really interesting points that I gathered from your presentation. Now, I would like to briefly introduce the panel. And again, highlight the nature of this panel. The idea is to have a multidisciplinary debate, not just the debate amongst lawyers, which, let's be honest, can be a bit boring. So we open it to a different kind of audience. And we'll start by bringing in my colleague at Strathclyde University, Professor Robert Kalin. Bob works at the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering. I've been working with him from not day one, from hour one when I arrived at Strathclyde University. And I think we work very well together. We bring different fields together. So he will comment, obviously, on his field of expertise, on hydrogeology, on the science, let's say. We'll then move to the second speaker, which is Dr. Naho Mirumachi. And I'm delighted to have you on this panel. Naho is a lecturer at the Department of Geography at King's College London. She's an expert in her field, and she brings to the panel a geography background, wider social science, if you want, which is incredibly important in these kind of debates. So thank you again for being with us. And we'll conclude with giving another international lawyer the possibility to comment, and this is Dr. Salman, which we are delighted to have. Again, we had him this morning, to have this afternoon with us. Salman is currently a fellow at the International Water Resources Association and the editor-in-chief of the journal published that will be published by Brill, International Water Law Journal. So I couldn't think of a better panel, and I will give the floor to Bob for, say, 10 minutes, but if you can even do it a little bit less, that would be great, so we can have then the audience bringing in some comments. Bob.
Fantastic. So, well, thank you very much for the introduction there. And thank you, Gabriel, for your insightful and interesting talk. There's two things I'd like to comment back on your talk. The first one is around that hydrogeology, putting on my hat as a hydrogeologist from the University of Arizona and also having studied some of those issues. The first transboundary issues I dealt with were in 1994 when I started working Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, the DC aquifer down into Saudi Arabia. And exactly that, at the when we first arrived out there, we had OXOD supporting a whole series of discussions, and each map exactly ended at the border. And I remember vividly having to cut them out, tape them together, and producing a transparency at that time of what the groundwater might be looking like flowing across those boundaries. And it's funny that here we are almost 30 years later, and we're still in the same situations because that data was collected in the 1980s. And the problem really comes back to exactly what you said, what is an aquifer? Now, actually, if I can pick up this cup right here, I'd rather have a bucket because it's a bit bigger, but I'll put the cup down right there because I think in this discussion we have to separate the cup from the water. The aquifer is actually, and I teach my students this as well, the aquifer is that geological unit that can store or transmit water, and I add on that it has an economic value to the end user. So at the end of the day, that water has some kind of economic value or value, whether it's for agriculture, for consumption, whatever it happens to be. So for a small community, a fractured rock saprolite system might be an aquifer because they only need water for 100 people. For a city of 10 million, the aquifer is going to be much different. So that helps you to try to define what you actually end up calling an aquifer, because first of all, it has to be a geological unit that can store and transmit water. The second, it has to meet the economic need that it's being utilized for. And within that, because you take the bucket separately, there's a time element, because under climate change in the past, it's been fuller or emptier, because we find waters throughout Scotland, the UK, all the way into other places that are hundreds of years old to tens of thousands or beyond years old. And I've done a lot of work on looking at paleo waters throughout the world. And what we might call an aquifer today might be different 15,000 years ago when it was more pluvial, because the depth of water in that system may have been different and its flow may have been different in the past. So I would suggest to the global transboundary governance and law field that we start separating out the resource, which is the water that's inside the cup, versus what the cup actually is. And that would actually help to start providing a little bit more of clarity around what we're looking for. So the second one is then about how much we understand what's in there and what the cup is actually is. And this is where I'm putting on a scientist's hat or an engineer's hat. I want data, and I want lots of data, and I want my government to give me lots of grants to actually get lots of data, because that keeps me giving publications, and it makes my international reputation that much better. But I also teach environmental forensics, and environmental forensics, just like we have problems here where we have uncertainty, when we're looking at a risk or an impact on a receptor from some kind of environment, whether it's an ecosystem or a human, it ends up being decided within civil law. And here in the UK, we call it balance of probabilities. And you are never going to be certain what the actual impacts were. But within law, you'll be actually trying to decide, is it 51% this one, 49% this one, or vice versa? And there's a balance of probabilities that come out of this. I think you will never, in transboundary aquifers or any hydrogeological system, come to a level of certainty that you actually can sit down across the table and have, whether it's two local communities or two international bodies actually agreeing the amount of data. But if we start thinking back to that balance of probabilities, the amount of data that we need to sit down and agree a balance of probabilities, that'll help shape how much data we really need to enter into formal agreements, and then the amount of data we'll need to actually continue to monitor that. And so those are my two comments that I'd like to bring to your talk, and some of the experience that I've had and that I share with my students, and hopefully it'll be of wider interest to those watching and to those who are actually here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bob. I now give the floor to Naho.
Thank you very much, and for the very interesting talk, and for the organizers for such a wonderful opportunity. And I think it's great that this is being live streamed to a broader audience as well. So I'll make three comments with a political geography hat on and a political science hat on. But I'm going to first start off with a confession. I recently wrote a book called Transboundary Water Politics in the Developing World, but groundwater gets very little mention, I have to say. I think it gets like maybe one line or two lines or something like that. And so I think I've also been, you know, equally sort of drawn into this uncertainty, not researching what we don't see, and focusing more on what we see, which tends to be rivers. Having said that, I think there are some insights that potentially could be useful in moving forward the discussion, both theoretically, academically, as well as more in terms of policy and grounded practice. And I think it's this point about how do we characterize the development over groundwater bodies, aquifers. And I think, Gabriel, what you've mentioned is a very interesting historical development of institutions being built. It's not as if we've not talked about it. It's been discussed in the forms of how can we put into place different articles, different principles, whether it's legally binding or not legally binding, how states can basically buy into these kind of institutions, what kind of challenges, obstacles there may be. So already we're seeing a process of cooperation being put in place through the process, through the trials and tribulations of institutionalization. But at the same time, we're seeing elements of conflict of state interests. So I think we have to be equally recognizing, just as transboundary rivers are not the stage for water wars or pure water cooperation, groundwater aquifers, transboundary aquifers, is also equally a stage where conflict and cooperation coexist. And it's a very nuanced landscape that we're navigating in. And so I appreciated Gabriel's talk for not, you know, characterizing groundwater as one of doom and gloom, that we don't have an international agreement in place, so we're all doomed, nor did you present it as a situation of a universal solution being made in the process. I think it was a very nuanced argument, a story that you were telling. The second point, I'm aware of time, so I'm going to move promptly on to my second point, is very similar to what you've just mentioned, Bob, about how do we deal with uncertainty. So Gabriel's talk really focused on what's the level of data that we have in various transboundary aquifers. And I found the maps that you showed towards the end on Mexico and the U.S. very powerful. It's so striking about how much we know and how much we don't know, and where the gaps are in terms of our scientific knowledge and scientific advances that we can make, the methodological differences that different disciplines have, different scholars have, different schools of thought have, and that's a really interesting element. But we as humans make choices and behave despite uncertainty all the time, every day. So we might take a job offer even though we actually don't know what's going to happen in the future, if our promotion prospects are going to be good or not good if we take on this job. So in many ways, while there is a critical and empirical level of uncertainty and information deficit regarding many of the transboundary aquifers, there already is, at the same time, a process going on, I would say a socio-cultural political process going on in dealing with this uncertainty. So behind all the signs, there already is certain discourses, there are certain narratives being played out about how we see the aquifer. Do we see the aquifer as a hidden resource that we can further tap into? Do we see it as a supplementary source to our existing surface waters or within a wider hydrological basin? So I think it's very important to recognize that this search for more information or refined scientific understanding is nonetheless couched within a broader political, socio-cultural context, that it's not just a purely, perhaps even neutral endeavor that we're doing to look for better boundaries of aquifers, improved understanding of recharge rates. These are all, in many ways, couched in how do we see water as an economic good on some levels, how we see water as a human right, how we see the transboundary aquifer as a potential for meeting national development goals in many developing countries. That could be an economic imperative, that could be a national development growth imperative as well. So trying to see these ways in which knowledge, information, uncertainty is being discussed and also being advanced within a broader context, I think is quite an important point. My third point, and this comes with a very big political geography hat on, is, wow, this is really interesting when it comes to scale, because a lot of the discussion that we've been having in water governance is multi-scalar water governance, that we need to appreciate that water governance happens at many scales. It's not just at the national scale. It can happen at the global scale. It can happen at the community scale. It can happen between individuals. So we need to understand multi-scalar water governance. We need to have better frameworks to be able to appreciate how these different scales interact. Where is groundwater going to fit in? Where is transboundary aquifer going to fit in? This is a really interesting question. I don't have an answer to this yet, but it really makes us question what is the role of scale when it comes to water governance, and to remind us that in many ways, scale is also a socially constructed issue that we conceive. So it might not, we tend to see the river basin as the natural hydrological unit, but in many ways that also is an element of the way in which we've justified our policies to assume that the hydrological unit is a natural unit and therefore should be the most appropriate unit to manage in. But that scale, I would argue, is a politically, socially constructed one, and the fact that we now are having more and more improved awareness and knowledge about transboundary aquifers makes me think, well, how does this fit into broader issues of multi-scalar governance? So I think I'll leave it there, and I'll hand it back over to you.
Thank you very much, Naho, for very comprehensive, very interesting comments. And I give the floor now to Salman. And after your comments, before I open it to the floor, I do want to give Gabriel the opportunity to react to any of the comments that you would like to. Salman.
Gabriel raised a number of issues which I found quite relevant and important. The first issue of the knowledge base being a major impediment to more work, whether legal, hydrological, or economics, or political on transboundary groundwater. The second issue is the issue that he raised, this issue of the state practice and the current trends. And I thought I would tie those points to my own experience, to my own hands-on experience at the World Bank when we worked on transboundary groundwater. How did we face those issues that Gabriel has raised from an academic point of view vis-a-vis the work that we did as a hands-on? And interesting enough, what I'm going to talk about is really a confirmation of what Gabriel said. The knowledge base is a major impediment. The question of state practice, if there is any, and whether it's consistent. And the third is the question which will take us further to the international organization practice. And then where does that take us with regards to current trends? The World Bank has a very elaborate and old policy called Projects on International Waterways. And the policy was developed from very early years of the World Bank work. When they started working on international rivers, they realized that they have a problem there and they have to meet. And so from very early years, they started developing a policy gradually. First policy was issued in 1956. It was only surface water, rivers, lakes, canals. It went on, revised in 1971, again, rivers, lakes, canals. And then it was revised again in the 80s. Again, there was no mention whatsoever of groundwater. And then we had to face the issues in the late 80s when we were looking at the policy again. And the question came, what do we do with groundwater? What do we do with transboundary groundwater? And there was almost unanimity within the technical staff. We cannot touch groundwater. Knowledge base, we don't have any knowledge. There is a major deficit. We already have problems with surface water. Please don't add to our headaches. Keep us there. There was really unanimity, and there was almost a revolt amongst the technical staff. Don't touch groundwater. And the issue was escalated. It went to the president's office. It went to the executive directors. And finally was a resolution, OK, leave groundwater. Let us deal with it as it arises and see what to do with it. So the main issue here, to confirming what Gabriel said, is the knowledge base, the deficit, the huge deficit. We don't know what is groundwater, what's transboundary groundwater, who's sharing it, how much is there. So it was left there. But in 1990, the World Bank faced the first challenge. The aquifer that Gabriel referred to, the northwestern Sahara aquifer, shared by Algeria and Morocco and Tunisia, at that time. And the bank was financing a project in Algeria, extracting water. This is a fossil aquifer. And the issue of Tunisia sharing the aquifer came up. And what do you do? And then there was a major uproar. Don't touch it. We are not going to talk to Tunisia. We don't even know whether Tunisia is sharing that aquifer or not. Fortunately for us in the legal department, there was a study that was prepared by UNESCO, which confirmed that the aquifer was shared between Tunisia and Algeria, and probably Morocco, and probably Libya, to the east and to the west. And that again added to the knowledge deficit and added to the confusion. Again, after a lengthy discussion, it was decided that the bank would notify Tunisia only, since we are not sure that it extends as far as Morocco or as far as Libya. And Algeria said, no way. This is my aquifer, this is my water, this is my land. This is just water beneath my land. What does Tunisia have to do with it? There was a major uproar, and Algeria was really very upset, and they said, we are not notifying anyone. The bank went out of its way, spoke to Tunisia about the project, and finally Tunisia agreed on with certain conditions about how much water is to be extracted, and that the World Bank should do another project in Tunisia to compensate Tunisia for the project that it was done in Algeria. That was basically what the Prime Minister told the President. Okay, go ahead. Do this project, but you have to do another project in Tunisia so that we know there is equitable and reasonable and fair share of the project. So that we went ahead with that, and the bank did the other project. But the question was really the knowledge base, the deficit in the knowledge. But the interesting thing here is that we noticed, as we were following up with the ILC convention, is that we are working in the opposite direction of the ILC. ILC was concentrating on connected groundwater and surface water. And here the World Bank is moving in direction of fossil water. We haven't touched any connected water. And that was a major thing that we noticed, that in practice, the problems are really more in fossil water because the other ones, there is no knowledge. We don't even know whether there is an aquifer, and if there is an aquifer, it's connected, and how much is the connection, and how much is the interaction between the two. But at least here we know that there is a fossil aquifer shared between two countries. So that was the first major distraction, or I would say moving away from the way the UN ILC convention was being developed at that time. But that was not. Then we had another project in the aquifer that Gabriel talked about, the DC aquifer shared by Jordan and Saudi Arabia. And we had a similar problem. Jordan would not notify Saudi Arabia. The bank notified Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia said, on my dead body, you are not touching this water. There is no way you can do this project. And it went on and on. And finally, the discussions were really between the king of Saudi Arabia and the king of the World Bank. They were together. They were talking about this project. And it was frozen for a while until an agreement would be reached between the World Bank, Jordan, and Saudi Arabia. Again, a fossil aquifer. By this time, the bank has started jumping in connected aquifers, aquifers that were connected to surface water. Or sometimes we might even jump into a river that's a national river connected to an international aquifer. And just the problems started compounding, started growing, just remushrooming, actually, that was the word we used. And for example, as I said, one challenge that we were faced with when we were dealing with the Gangetic aquifer shared between Bangladesh and India, India told us, look, land is owned by the individuals, and the individuals own whatever is under the land. So not only it's not Delhi, it's not even the province or the state that we cannot touch it. Whatever is in the land and whatever is beneath the land is owned by the owner. So don't bring to us any groundwater issues because it's beyond our authority, beyond our responsibility. That became a major challenge. Same thing was said by Pakistan. Federal countries start raising the same issues to us. What groundwater goes with the land. The land is not the responsibility of the central government, so don't bring it. That was a major challenge and a major impediment to our work. The other challenge that we faced was the question of the connection between the groundwater and between groundwater and surface water. And we thought that would be easier because of the UN Convention. And however, it became more difficult. And let me backtrack, and I remember Saudi Arabia when we were doing the DC Amman project. Saudi Arabia told us, look, I mean, probably they talked to an international lawyer, it's probably Gabriel. Look, the UN Convention talks about connected groundwater. This is not connected, so why are you doing it? This is none of your business, it's not part of international law, and it should not be part of your policy. So they use the convention as a defense shield, as don't touch, there is really, you shouldn't do anything here, because this is not part of international law, not part of international water law. Then we face a project in Turkey. A local aquifer, domestic aquifer in Turkey, but was connected to the Tigris and Euphrates. There was one study, I don't remember the name of the aquifer. And we felt that, okay, if this connected and it's charging and recharged from the Tigris and Euphrates, then we have to deal with Iraq and Syria. And Turkey said, on my dead body, you're not dealing with Iraq and Syria on Tigris and Euphrates. And now you're going to deal with them on a local aquifer. And the bank has to scrap that project because of the issues. And they just kept saying, you know, we don't have, you guys and we and the whole world doesn't have enough information to warrant a conclusion that this aquifer is connected to the Tigris and Euphrates. And so your policy doesn't apply here because you don't have a knowledge base for it. We showed some studies, they said, no, we don't agree with those studies. We do our own studies, and our own studies show there's no connection. So that became another problem. And as I mentioned earlier, Libya joined the UN Convention. And one of they met with us at the World Bank at one point and said, the sandstone Nubian aquifer is connected to the Nile. It is being fed by the Nile. How much water, we don't know, but we are sure it's fed by the Nile. So we want the World Bank to establish this fact because we want to be a Nile state. And then the bank realized that this is really going too far beyond what the bank had in mind about this is a shared aquifer. So this is another problem that is being raised with some political ambitions, hydropolitical ambitions of connecting the Nubian sandstone and the Nile so that Libya would be classified as a Nile state. We had a problem with the São Francisco River in Brazil. And we had a project there, a major project, and then the issues were raised. To what extent is the São Francisco River connected to the Guarani aquifer? It's a river full of water, but the size of the river is small, but the size of water is large. And there were lots of talk about connection, about actually this river is being mainly fed from the Guarani aquifer because of the huge amount of the water in the Guarani aquifer. So another problem, no knowledge base, no political will between the parties to resolve it, and it just stayed there. So we had all those. This is those are the kind of problems that we face. This is the Amazon and the Guarani Aquifer and the Amazon River. So the challenges are major, I mentioned connections between rivers, the question of the knowledge base, and the question between the connection of between rivers and aquifers, and national rivers, international aquifers, and vice versa, international aquifers and national rivers. This is a sandstone aquifer, and how the Libyans are claiming that it's connected to the Nile. They measured the distance, and they spoke about the slope, and they brought a study which shows that they did by themselves, showing the slope and showing the, and they said yes, it's not a fossil aquifer. Number one, it is connected to the Nile and fed by the Nile, and so this is, and again there was another small aquifer, and this when I asked Gabriel about the bodies and the aquifers, this is the called Northern Darfur underground mega lake, which Baz spoke about in a number of conferences. And the question, this is, in my view, as I'm not really that good in groundwater, but I thought this is exactly the case that Gabriel was talking about, the bodies. You have here a body, and you have a larger body, and so those are two bodies. How much of connection, how much of interaction, we still don't know. It's again the knowledge base. And this brings me to my conclusion. This is Darfur and the water there. And the conclusion is that the bank policy took the risk step of recognizing transboundary groundwater, although the policy still doesn't have the words groundwater, but the problems are the knowledge base, sovereignty, and the connection between surface water and groundwater and vice versa. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Salman. Gabriel, I don't want you to answer all the questions. There weren't really a lot of questions. It was more comments and so forth. But before I open it to the audience, by all means, if there's a few points that you want to highlight, discuss.
I'll try to address some of the comments together. First of all, as I said, this is a very frustrating situation, but also very exciting, because there's so much lack of information, so much mismanagement, but so much opportunity for all of us here to get involved in and learn about and help develop. We're at the very beginning of global groundwater management, transboundary aquifer management on a global scale. We're at the very, very beginning. And the opportunity for all of you to get involved is fantastic, because there's very few people who are even beginning to understand this. I don't claim to understand all this. There's no way. We're just now starting to understand all the implications and the possibilities. And so really, really great opportunity. I didn't go for doom and gloom, because I don't know if it's doom and gloom yet. And in fact, I'd rather do the opposite and be positive about it. And yes, we have a lot of absence of knowledge and a lot of scarcity and so on, but there's so much opportunity that if we can generate the knowledge and the information, to me, that's what's going to be more productive in terms of achieving something positive out of what we don't know. And so based on what I want to achieve, what I'd like to see globally we can achieve, I don't oppose agreements at all, even as much as we don't know. In fact, I would say that we should have agreements on procedures. As I said in my talk, ignore the rights. Put aside water rights, water allocation, I get this, you get, put that all aside, because right now what we need is agreements to generate information. And that's all the procedural steps, the data exchange, the monitoring. That's where I think we can have tremendous value, and that will build trust for future potential allocation and management. So I do think we can do this, and we can do it on a local level as well as at a global level. On the point you made earlier, these aquifers are locally specific, and they have to be locally managed. You cannot manage the aquifers on the U.S.-Mexico border from Washington, D.C. and Mexico City. There has to be local involvement, because each aquifer is going to be somewhat different. Just like the Rio Grande and the Colorado River are different, you're going to have the same kind of different characteristics for groundwater, and they have to have individualized attention. Let me stop there, so if there's any questions from the audience. And
okay. Thank you. Questions, comments from the audience? If you could say who you are, your professional affiliation, and for the benefit of the debate, as much as we want to expand, let's try to keep it brief, both from the audience and from Gabriel or anybody else who wants to come in.
Maratignino from the University of Geneva. Many thanks, Gabriel, for your presentation. I would like to ask, you underlined this lack of knowledge, of exchange of information. Do you think that the principle of sovereignty, and now we have a specific provision in the ILC draft articles, plays a role? What is your opinion about this in the context of the management of transboundary aquifers?
Yes, the principle of sovereignty that made its way into the draft articles is a major challenge. But the draft articles would not have gotten to in front of the UN General Assembly without that provision. Ambassador Yamada, who guided the development of those draft articles, went back and forth between the Sixth Committee, the ILC, the experts group on which I was involved with, UNESCO, all these groups, trying to manage expectations. And because of the lack of knowledge, I think the position was, as some of you articulated, I think Salman, you articulated, it's mine, it's on my territory, so it's my land, there's no question about it. And that notion of sovereignty and lack of understanding of water flowing underneath the ground or within the soil, you can't see it, you can't touch it. So it's that conceptual aspect. I think it's a big challenge, and it's unfortunate. I agree with Steve McCaffrey. I'm not as pessimistic as he is about the presence of that provision in there. I don't think it spells the ruin of the draft articles, but it is a big challenge. And that's where I think ignore all the substantive provisions, go for the procedurals.
Can you give it to that? Do you have any further questions?
Comment?
Yes, Bob, you can comment and while Laura gets to the rest.
Okay, just quickly about that as well. Going back to the DC, I remember when we first started working through the IAEA isotope hydrology program there, and exactly there's no agreements. And then we, on both sides and all in the area, we radiocarbon dated the groundwater. I was the expert that was going out and helping doing all the interpretation on that. And as soon as you put a map and you lined up the ages, it was obvious where the water was going, because it happened between now and 25,000 years ago, but it was obvious which direction was flowing because you could just see it getting older. And that then started opening people's minds. Yeah, there is definitely probably water flowing across the borders. So it doesn't have to be all this detailed data. There can be simple things like an isotope hydrology that allows us to actually set the frameworks. And then the other side of that coin is when we're working in those areas, of course, there's no rainfall. But globally, 98% of the water we actually have access to is fresh water is beneath the ground. And what we keep coming back to is the surface water conventions as ideas. And that's why I brought up the balance of probabilities. That we will never understand what's happening underneath the ground. So we have to move away from data intensive to simplifying ideas that allow us to agree the level at which we can start agreeing. And I think that's going to be really important in these conventions, is to move away from some of the detail and come back to some of the bigger picture type of interpretations, like the carbon-14 dating or age dating, isotope hydrology, things that we did in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, which seem to almost have fallen out of an awful lot of this work.
We have two comments from up there.
Hi, yes, my name is Mallory Orm. I'm working on my LLM here in International Law and Sustainable Development. Thank you to all of the panelists. That was very interesting and informative. My question is primarily for Gabriel. In regards to the 2006 Transboundary Aquifer Assessment Act, I was wondering, the act was passed with the purpose of learning more about the four priority assessment aquifers, and I was wondering, it was passed with a budget for 10 years in 2006, so that's due to run out very shortly. So I was wondering if you think it'll be likely this comprehensive agreement will come about in the next couple of years, and if so, if that will be in the form of a minute to the IBWC, or if that will be a separate agreement altogether.
When you say comprehensive agreement, where,
the comprehensive agreement on groundwater management mentioned in the minute 242.
Oh, in the minute. Mm-hmm. Oh, the, from 1973.
Yep.
Yeah. No. That provision in minute 242 is not directly related to the TAP, to the Transboundary Aquifer Assessment Act, which is a U.S. Legislative act signed by President Bush, President Bush, and it was authorized, I think, $50 million for 10 years. So far, they've barely given $2 million because it's a two-step process. You can authorize the project, but then you have to authorize the funding. And you know what happened in 2008, global recession, and so there was very little money that was actually authorized for it. They have started doing work on the priority aquifers. As you mentioned, there's four of them. But it's even those projects are struggling for information because they don't have the funding coming in. I don't see funding coming in through the U.S. Congress anytime soon before the act expires, which then goes to the next question. Are we going to have a border-wide agreement? Not for a while. Not for a very long while because, again, it's an interests issue, and neither government seems to be interested. So this goes back to the point on local interest. The local population and the first article I had in my list there advocates exactly that. See if it's possible to generate information locally and see if the locals can at least have a handshake agreement. Just like we have these MOUs and MOAs on a variety of locations around the world, let's start at least at that level because, in fact, they're really interested. The needs there are tremendous, and they know it, and they know their aquifers.
Thank you.
I think Kate had a question.
Yeah.
Yes. Professor Gabriel, thank you so much for your presentation. And the case study that you presented about U.S. and Mexico. It seems you were able to come up with some data that you were able to use and come up with the results that you were able to. But it still comes back to the issue of data management between countries. And I think it's not just about U.S. and Mexico. It's all over. Would you recommend the method you use to be the method that should be used in case of coming up with to come up with aquifers and identify them, or you think we still need to do more and find a better way where we can actually be straight and say, okay, this is the way we should be going?
At this point, where it is such an early stage of knowledge, of coordination, of management, I don't know if there's a right way to do things. We're just a couple of academics that decided to go out on a limb and try to call people and get this information. And we've been actually very fortunate that we've been able to gather this information. I don't know if the same strategy, if you call this a strategy, if it'll work in another part of the world. Other parts of the world, I know for a fact that there is no information. So you can't, whether it's academics or government officials, you can't go out and gather what's not there. So what's needed is an agreement to generate the information, which, yes, it requires funding and strategizing. But, again, I can't overemphasize this enough. I think we focus so much internationally on water rights. We do that tremendously on these non-navigational uses agreements, the Water Course Convention, a lot of the local, regional agreements, the binational agreements, how much do you get, how much we get, equitable, reasonable utilization. And we seem to, at times, not always, put aside the procedural aspects, the idea that we need to cooperate procedurally, not just substantively, but procedurally, and come up with procedural mechanisms to generate the data, to exchange the data, to harmonize the data. I mean, harmonizing, that's one that everybody seems to forget. Let's generate it. Great. Well, use that methodology. He uses that method. Oh, now it doesn't fit. It doesn't work because you use different techniques. So little things like that, if we can get countries to forge agreements, whether they're informal or formal agreements, on procedures to generate and develop and share data, that I think will at least establish a basis for cooperation and trust. And maybe some point in the future, then we can talk about water rights if we really want to. So to that extent, that might address some of your points in terms of how much data do we need and what type of data and what kind of agreements we need. You're right. We don't need a lot to get started. I don't think we need any data to get started as long as we have an agreement to generate and to start generating data and cooperating.
So, question from Stephanie and then from Mark. Mm-hmm. And from the members of the panel, if you do want to comment on any of the questions, by all means, please.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Hawkins from Strathclyde Centre of Environmental Law and Governance. And Professor Eckstein, I agree with you that there's too much focus on the substantive principles of international law. But I wanted to ask, I'm wondering, what do you think about about procedure being used to lead to outcomes that might be potentially unfair or lead to a violation of the substantive principles of international law? So, or have you seen this happen? For example, states locking themselves into unfair outcomes by agreeing on procedures or consenting to development that ultimately cause them harm in the long run, but they have less of a legal basis to claim against that because they've consented during the procedure. So I just wanted to hear what you think about that, and maybe Naho, you have an opinion on that as well. Thank you.
From a transboundary aquifer point of view, no, I haven't seen it because we just have so little experience. From a transboundary water experience, I think it's lots of experience, and you can probably talk more about this, about, you know, hegemonic influence over arrangements, agreements, coordination. I think it is a concern, but you can probably.
A quick note to say that cooperation is not without its risks. I mean, you are tying your hands in many aspects to what may happen in the future, and so it's very problematic to just think that having procedural principles or substantive principles in place would solve the situation. I think it's really about the deliberation that goes on what kinds of principles you put in place and also how you implement them afterwards as well. And this is where I think you start seeing the power politics come into play.
Salman, and then we go to Mark.
From my experience with the World Bank and from my experience working with the Sudanese government on the Nubian sandstone aquifer, we took the position, and I personally took the position that yes, there are principles of international water law. They apply here, but with all the problems that we're having, issues of sovereignty, issues of state practice, issues of hegemony, the best way to start is try to agree on a joint management mechanism. That's where I think we can help. And that has happened in the sandstone aquifer. They have put together four people from those countries. It's not a sitting mechanism, but at least they are exchanging data and information and meeting from time to time. The same thing is happening on the DC aquifer on the agreement that we haven't seen, but we have read some experts about it in the newspapers, that Saudi Arabia and Jordan have decided to establish a committee. And I think that would be where the basic deficit that we are talking about and Gabriel has concentrated on, about knowledge base. That's where the knowledge base can be expanded. More information about the groundwater, about that particular aquifer, will be collected. It will be non-biased in terms of participation of at least the countries that we know at that stage that they share that aquifer. And I think that would be the beginning of going forward with other principles of international law, international water law with regards to transboundary aquifers. You agree, Gabriel?
Yeah. Thanks. My name is Mark Squillaci. I teach at the University of Colorado Law School. And I guess I'd like to sort of build on a comment that Dr. Salman made regarding the distinction between fossil groundwater and interconnected surface and groundwater, and ask, I guess, a question about how we sort of deal with that problem in the context of sort of trying to confront the need for agreements on transboundary aquifers. Gabriel, you talked about the problem with the Mexican and U.S. border, and it's an interesting case study in some ways, because I think when you're dealing with these two different river systems, the Rio Grande and the Colorado, you're looking at two different kinds of problems with respect to groundwater interactions. Along the Rio Grande, which forms the border between Texas and Mexico, there clearly must be some ground and surface water interconnections that are directly related to decisions that are being made along that border. Along the Colorado, I think it's much more complicated, because the much of the groundwater that is interconnected, and there is a lot of groundwater that's interconnected, is well above the border. And so states and parties are taking water out of the Colorado River system, if you will, or appear to be taking water out of the system, but that's not really being noticed directly at the border until the river gets down there. And I'm just wondering, you were talking about process, Gabriel, in particular, and, you know, let's focus on process, but isn't this sort of an important process question about when you decide to treat an agreement as being sort of an amendment or an addendum to an existing surface water agreement, or when you're in a situation where you have what you're going to characterize at least as fossil groundwater and you deal with that aquifer separately? Are there lines that we can draw here, or should we be trying to draw lines on this?
I can't give you a straightforward answer. It's a best I can do is give you a good lawyer answer. It depends. you know, when we were working with the ILC on the draft articles, we got into huge discussions over. Multiple discussions, one of which was, should we really be developing some kind of draft articles or mechanism instrument for groundwater if it's connected to surface water, or shouldn't we just actually scrap the water course convention and have a water convention so that the Colorado River and its hydraulically related aquifers, or the Rio Grande and its hydraulically related aquifers, should be managed collectively? That was the ideal that the hydrogeologist and the hydrologist wanted, and that the lawyers were amenable to. And then it got to the ILC and the Sixth Committee, and it was just pushed right back. Politics, sovereignty, lack of understanding, I don't know. We ended up with the Water Course Convention, and now we have this draft articles, and if the draft articles ever make it to whatever status, they're going to have to be harmonized. Obviously. That's going to have to happen somehow. As the other point about fossil aquifers, and I don't know if part of the question suggests, do we need a separate kind of regime for fossil aquifers because they're independent and unique? That's been argued. It was argued when we were dealing with the draft articles, and it's still argued today. Most fossil aquifers don't really have a flow, and if they do have a flow, it's very limited, very, you know, insignificant, to the point where you can really say, hey, this is my land, this water underneath here, it's not really moving, it's right there, it's just like oil, gas, not quite coal, but a mineral, which is different from flowing water. Does that matter? I don't have a good answer. All I can say is water is different from oil, gas, coal, and so on, so maybe I want to treat it more like water in general. I like the law of the hydrocycle theory. But we haven't gotten to the point where very little state practice and a lot of people arguing ideas. And I can't tell you where the trend is. It's certainly not on fossil aquifers.
Bob wanted to comment, then Salman, and then I have Sheila.
I'll be totally 180 degrees. fossil aquifers are active. Their recharge may have been in the past, but the water is still flowing today. So it's not just a puddle of water sitting there not moving. So fundamentally, that's a misconception that I've seen throughout the world on the discussions of these things. Okay, I'm trying to be a little kind of the second. I actually my PhD was on the geochemical evolution and groundwater flow modeling of the Tucson Basin, which underlies the Santa Cruz River Basin, which is one of these basins right here. So actually, I know a little bit about some of these basins that flow across, and I did a lot of radiocarbon dating for the RASA program for the USGS. I worked throughout the Middle East on radiocarbon dating all the aquifers throughout the Middle East. I worked in parts of Asia, South Asia, in India, some things. I've taught in Africa on these issues. And what always gets me is you know, we constantly come back to this data. I'll go back. 98% of the water in the world that's available for us to use is in the ground. So letting the surface water conventions at all wag the tail of that dog, I think, runs into big problems. But unfortunately, we could see a river flowing, but we can't see the groundwater. In the Santa Cruz Basin, what happens is there were pluvial events in the past. There is groundwater recharging from the mountains, which come down in the wadis or the washes. They recharge very quickly there, and they tend to flow in fingers out into these basins. And then what happens is I get a layer of water, and then I'll have a dry period, and I have a layer of water. And we found nicely layered, you know, a few hundred years old, 800 years old, 1,200 years old, 2,400 years old, whole histograms that I've published on the ages of these waters, where what you had is you had different climatic regimes. Like we had the big ENSO coming in right now. Those ENSO periods tend to have huge flood events and then lots and lots of recharge that would go in, and then it would settle down into a layer of water. So these things are vertically stratified. Myself, Neil Plummer at the USGS, others have seen these. Turley Serling and stuff, some of his work in Nevada, he saw these things. But the problem is, for some reason, this knowledge isn't for somehow connecting together. That's why when Francesco arrived here, I thought, I got to meet this guy, and we need to start working together, because it's the harmonization of those two things and making sure that when I read something in a UNESCO IHP document talking about an aquifer, that's not an aquifer. We can actually start correcting some of these things and making sure that the language allows for that. And then my final point, going back to the balance problem, this is arbitration. I agree 100% with you guys. We should move away from, how do we do the process, and agree what is it we're going to arbitrate on. And I think the initial agreement on that arbitration, that's why I'm really thinking more from civil point of view, is let's agree what we're going to try to agree and then move forward on that, rather than trying to agree what data we need to agree, because then you can just running around in circles.
At least three people in the audience who want to intervene. So, Gabriel, you demanded a reply.
Yeah, after Salman, please.
Salman, briefly.
I think it's maybe it's more fairer to give the audience.
Gabriel, okay. You demanded a reply on Bob.
So. Yes. us dim-witted lawyers.
Talk for
and
yourself.
You know what? No, because it's true. I readily admit, it is a struggle for many of us lawyers and certainly politicians to understand the geologic time period we're talking about. Yeah. Because agreements and regulations and laws are based on use. So to that extent, when we were debating this with the ILC, to try to talk about, is this a fossil aquifer even though it's negligible recharge? Well, it's recharge. Oh, no, but it's a 10,000 years. Okay, then it's a fa. Where do you draw the line? How do you define aquifers in the context of recharging or not recharging? What's a safe yield? How do you define that in relation to the use? Because that's what they really want. They want to be able to use the water. So these notions, these hydrogeologic notions, they form the very foundation of the laws and regulations. But when you get to writing those laws and regulations, they seem to evaporate because it's based on use and what we want and what we need. And so I agree that there's flow in fossil aquifers, but not at the scale or the rates that the lawyers and the politician, the legislature understand for the purposes of can I use it, how much can I use, and how long can I use it for. And it's really unfortunate to try to draft laws that will last 10,000 years because the aquifer's life, you know, recharge rate.
I know it's late in the day, but I will ask the panel experts on the panel to challenge you to actually take three questions together, because if we start going every question, we'll never conclude, as interesting as it is. So I'll ask, I have one, two, and three. One point on my side. At Strathclyde, the great thing that is we have been able to work lawyers, hydrogeologists, and also the accounting, the finance, the economics. So also the interesting point is if you have an aquifer, and I've seen this in the Guarani, where the groundwater is so deep in the aquifer that it's not economically recoverable. Mm-hmm. To be honest, for the politician, that's not relevant. And
not
my colleague, and colleagues at the University of Sao Paulo talk about, and it's very much what you were saying at the beginning. So you see the links between law, hydrogeology, the economics are all incredibly relevant. So three questions, if you can please take a note who wants to answer, and that way we can get the three questions together.
Sheila O'Reilly, IOD Park, is an even more dim-witted development practitioner. My question is around perhaps whether or not development agencies, including the World Bank and DFID and others who fund work on tapping aquifers for large-scale agriculture development, for energy and for drinking water, at what point do the questions of use need the role of lawyers, the role of politicians, and the precautionary principle kind of coincide? Because I am very concerned. I accept Bob's point of large scale long-term recharge, but in the more shorter human time scale, are we actually, and I think this is a question to Bob as well, is there a risk map anywhere of where there are transboundary aquifers, large scale agriculture development, large communities who are reliant on them? Do we have risk maps about this kind of thing? Or are we actually encouraging people to use water at a rate that they wish to use it, but actually in the one or two lifetimes, their needs will no longer continue to be met? And I'm just getting slightly kind of pessimistic. I know you're an optimist, I'm a pessimist. Thank you.
Ruby.
I just wanted to, my name is Ruby Moynihan and I'm at the Edinburgh Law School. I just want to follow up on the draft articles, the 2008 draft articles, because you were involved in the process of at least the scientific committee, and so might have a bit of an idea about where these articles might go or where they're at the moment. And I just think Mara mentioned some of the challenges and objections to the draft articles, and I just wanted to link it to that broader idea, and it comes through in the presentation a lot as well, is that what we have in international law is an obligation through the Vienna Convention to make sure that treaties that address the same subject matter are mutually supportive in the way they interpret and provide for the protection of the environment or the protection of anything. And there's been a lot of debate around the fact that the 2008 articles, draft articles, were not consistent or coherent with the UN Water Course Convention. And so obviously that's led to some stalling on progress forward with these. I mean, can you talk about ways in which the two could be, or the draft articles themselves could be adapted so they could be more coherent with the convention itself? Do you think the draft articles will always remain in draft? Or will they ever enter into force and become a legally binding instrument? Yeah, would appreciate.
Laura, we have Andrea there.
Thank you very much. I'm Andrea Coulson. I'm based in the Department of Accounting and Finance here at Strathclyde Business School and working with Francesco and Bob on transboundary aquifers. One of the comments that I'd like to make is that I've found this engagement so valuable in terms about
of understanding from different disciplinary perspectives, as well as others, what we know and what we don't know, and how knowledge is created. And you know, I think that's the gift of today. One of my areas of interest is corporate accountability. And the group that we haven't talked much about today, I'm not sure if we have mentioned them, is the private sector, who are very much interested in using and abusing water. And I'm wondering how much, from your experience, you think that corporates know, how much are they engaged in this debate that we're having? Because it strikes me that, you know, when I think about the resource that Coca-Cola are using, there's cooperation and conflict around that, certainly. And if I think about the alternatives that we're potentially putting the empty cup to when we talk about, you know, carbon dioxide storage, for example, and the potential business opportunities from this, that there is knowledge in the private sector, you know, that we access that at our peril, I think. But I'm just, I would like your reflections on involvement of the corporate sector, please.
Thank you very much. I think I will let the panel pick and choose to some extent. And even if it's maybe a field that you're not too familiar, if you're happy to pitch in, that would be lovely. Shall we start with Bob and then finish with Gabriel?
Okay. Well, out of all those, there's two things I would like to see in the draft convention. I haven't read it every single line all the way through. But one thing that we see, going back to what's driven the private sector in environmental degradation, has been the polluter pays principle. So whether we're talking about overuse of fossil waters or the contamination of younger waters that are more renewable, a polluter pays principle that would come in there, or an overuse principle, would allow people to actually say, well, okay, what do I actually have as a long-term financial risk? Therefore, I can actually start coming up with what is my, as it is right now, an environmental risks that I have in the long term, and people can start putting numbers onto that, whether that's a national or a company. So if we were to have some kind of mechanism there that if I over-exploited something and I've actually caused damage to that, then there's a mechanism for actually looking to start recovering that. Again, the problem with that is we don't even understand it enough to come up with an agreement, let alone starting to apply a impact and therefore some kind of tax or whatever else onto it. So that's the first thing I would bring. And the second one is I think what we do need is a lot more of this engagement where we actually have the scientists, the economics, the social scientists, and the people in law working across all these things together. Because I think I'm a bit strange when it comes to science. I actually enjoy these types of interactions, but sometimes when people move out of their comfort zones, it's very difficult. And it's nice to see the number of people that are actually starting to engage with this. So I would call upon all my scientists out there to get out of their laboratories and get out of their number crunching and actually come in and see if they can put some kind of meaningful interpretation onto the work that they're actually doing.
Okay, so I think I'll take on the first question, and I think my response will also touch upon the third comment about businesses. So about risk mapping, and are the development agency actually doing a damaging thing intervening? I think the ultimate question here is sustainability is what society makes of it. And regardless of the level of data or the amount of data, the sort of level of social acceptability of environmental bads, environmental burdens, the cost benefits, these are something that gets deliberated in a social context. And therefore, you have situations where businesses actually are probably very acutely aware of how much water is there and what kind of trade-offs they would have if they invest in a particular region, what their sort of exit strategy is, and what kind of other production schemes that they would look into should one body of water resources fail, etc. So it's really then again, how do we ensure that people who benefit from having access to these aquifers, how do the people who actually bear the burden, the environmental burden, how do all these people come to the negotiation table and be able to discuss this in a deliberative fashion? And I think creating that deliberative space is very, very important and something that we really don't seem to talk about in concrete terms. So we do talk about governance, we talk about multi-scalar governance, we try and talk about public and private and civil society coming together, but when we actually come to defining governance, what does it look like? What does good governance look like? What does good water governance, what does good transboundary aquifer water governance look like? I think we're very, very far away from that situation. So I think engaging with these quite tricky, elusive, and also highly politically charged questions, I think really need to be constantly in the background and in the foreground as well.
Salman?
I will follow up on Sheila's questions and Naho's comments about the should international financial institutions really finance projects that extract water from fossil aquifer as a question of sustainability, as a question of fairness to future generations. And I think that's a very relevant question. And it was raised not only in the World Bank, but in meetings of international financial institutions. And there was an unwritten agreement that we should do this under very harsh conditions and very difficult conditions. First, look at the alternatives. Surface water, if there is any surface water in the area, then stay away from fossil aquifer. Look at the other country alternatives, desalination. Look at the regional alternatives, water trade, like what's happening between Singapore and Malaysia or Hong Kong and China. So there have been, and that came exactly on the case of the DC aquifer, where the bank was supposed to finance a project that conveys water from the DC aquifer shared between Jordan and Saudi Arabia to Amman. And all those factors were put there, and it was agreed that first, there are no other alternatives. The Jordan River is drying up. There is no water in the Jordan River. The Dead Sea is dying because of that. And second, there are no the question of desalination because the cost is high. Jordan cannot tolerate it. There is no issue of water trade within the region because there is no water in the region. And we could finance under those conditions, we could finance the project, but it has to be a limited project. It has to keep in mind the question of sustainability and the question of future, the fairness of future generations.
Gabriel.
Well, thank you for all of these questions, wonderful questions. Obviously, I can't answer each one. I will stay afterwards if anybody want, if I didn't get to any of your pretty good questions. I think I'll touch on the draft articles. Harmonization issue, they will have to be harmonized. I don't think that is a factor that is preventing them from making progress. Francesco and I wrote an article together that talks about the process of the draft articles going through the UN General Assembly and that they keep getting tabled. Ambassador Yamada, and we wrote about this, and I remember talking to the ambassador about this, he was very wary that this would get very far because of the sovereignty concerns, because of the lack of understanding. We brought in people from UNESCO, scientists trying to have education sessions with the Sixth Committee, with the ILC, to try to at least give them a basic foundation so that they can then understand why these rules are being presented and their value. And it was very challenging, and so we still ended up with the norm of sovereignty as that third provision, the third draft article. And so Ambassador Yamada's vision was something along the lines of the draft articles on state responsibility, which have been, from some perspective, just languishing in front of the General Assembly for, gosh, what is it now, a decade, 2 decades? I don't know how long.
2 decades.
Except, if you'll notice, how many of those provisions arguably have sort of filtered their way into customary international law? De facto, because states are able to sort of test drive some of those principles and maybe test those principles without being forced to through a convention. And so this is Ambassador Yamada. I think it was pretty shrewd. He was hoping it would get delayed and tabled over and over. So the countries can test them out. And if they don't like the sovereignty eventually, they won't make it into the final draft. If they do like the equitable utilization, it will make it in the final draft. And again, without any notion of what the final draft will look like or the final form, is it going to be a convention or a protocol to the Watercourses Convention or guidelines? So the fact that they're still in front of the General Assembly, I don't think it's a negative. I think it's actually a positive because we have so little experience. I think it's a great argument to say that what's contained in the draft articles is progressive development. It's not codification of current law because, as I suggested in my talk, we really don't have much to go on to say this is the current status of international law. So maybe this is sort of a way to develop surreptitiously customary law, letting them test drive, see which rules they like. Maybe they'll develop some of their own. But this is something that will take time. So,
thank you, Gabriel. I'm sure there could be more debate, but I think it's time to get it to a close. We have been talking this morning 2 hours about the Watercourses Convention. We have talked in the afternoon another 2 hours of water media issues. We have now almost gone 3 hours with transboundary aquifers. I don't know of many other places where we can talk 8 hours about water, law, policy, media. So already that, and most of us are still here, so that's a good thing. Before I close today's session, let me just say one point that you highlighted. Well, two. One of the great things of being now at Strathclyde is that, as you said, despite the fact you have people, even in this room, who have worked on transboundary aquifers through isotopes, through projects at the World Bank for some time, you said this is still a new field. This is still a field where we can contribute to something. Not the only one, obviously, but it is an exciting field. And at Strathclyde, we have the opportunity to do it in a multidisciplinary environment. At the law school, we now have 2 PhD researchers focusing on this topic, a postdoc who's with us for 2 years, and most likely a third PhD. That's a team of 5 of us, 2 of which are being co-supervised by an engineer, so that can happen. And it's really allowing us to have, I wouldn't say these kind of conversations on a biweekly basis, but almost. And that's really fascinating. And with that, I would like to once again thank the 4 speakers. I would like to thank the university, the Scottish government for supporting this event, the team behind it at the center, the Strathclyde Centre for Mental Law and Governance, the admin team at the law school. But I think it is now time for all of us to move into another room. And we may not have a dram of some particularly treated water which is particularly famous in Scotland, but I do think we have some interesting liquid called wine that is calling for us. So thank you very much to all of you.